Welcome to Spokes Nation, the podcast of the Bike Scouts community. We are podcasting from the Philippines, where we are based, in a very small city called San Pedro that's sandwiched between a lake to the east that's actually a caldera of a potentially active volcano and the recently active Taal volcano to the west. The weather here is great. The volcanoes, not so much. I'm Miles, by the way. I'm the founder of Bike Scouts. Bike Scouts is a social platform where people come together to do things that matter in our own communities and the world at large. With the support of our growing global community, Bike Scouts is also the only volunteer bicycle messenger service in the world that provides last-mile access to people and places affected by severe disasters, providing an alternative means of communication and access to essential supplies using bicycles, good old human passion, and technology. Bike Scouts has been around for the past 7 years, and the community is local to the places where we ride. This is how we've always been connected to the things that happen around the Philippines. Recently, we've all been affected by the global COVID-19 pandemic, and one of the biggest things to come from this globally disruptive event is the sudden surge in cycling. People all over the world have suddenly rediscovered, or are just discovering, the value of bicycles for everyday mobility. The Philippines is one place that has seen this dramatic rise in the volume of bicycles on city roads and pretty much everywhere else around the country. In a lot of ways, this is a very good thing, especially in the age of the climate crisis and the ever-growing problem of road congestion that most cities on Earth have been misguidedly trying to fix by adding more roads that just fill up with even more cars and other motor vehicles that cause an endless problem of traffic. Us Filipinos like to think of traffic as one of those things that you just have to deal with because it's there. But according to a study by the Asian Development Bank that was recently published in the New York Times, Metro Manila, which is the metropolitan area that includes the capital city of the Philippines, is the most congested of 24 cities that it surveyed across South and Southeast Asia. In the same article, Japan's development agency estimates that the cost of traffic to Manila's economy is more than $72 million. Or, to put that into perspective, 3.5 billion Philippine pesos every single day. That is not something that you can just put up with. It's a serious matter. But all of this was really just a build-up for the real topic that I wanted to discuss. It's something that also involves traffic and something that we're seeing more and more every day as government lockdowns are slowly eased and motor vehicles take to the road again. But this time, with a greater volume of bicycles that are now on the road. Let's talk about bike rage. It's like road rage, but with bicycles, and sometimes with colorful, stretchy pants and matching gloves and helmets. Wikipedia defines bike rage as a form of road rage in which acts of verbal or gestural anger or physical aggression between cyclists and other users of bike paths or roadways, including pedestrians, other cyclists, motorcyclists, and drivers. In the Philippines, the altercation is not limited to the road where these incidents happen. A lot of times, both motorists and cyclists take it online to social media, where the rage goes on and on for days, fueled by the comments and side comments of others that happily throw in even more bad words, idle threats, and generally bad advice to the fire. In the Philippines, we like to say things like, "Kung ako yan," which is Filipino for "if it was me in that situation," and "Ang gagawin ko," which means "this is what I would do." And then it quickly escalates from there with suggestions of various ways to show superior masculinity. Sometimes it also leads to very long conversations about blame, as though finding somebody to blame will make things right. Of course, it won't. Dangerous road use habits will just continue, and anger is never the answer. A lot of times, road rage just becomes another excuse for people to form a mob and gain some feeling of victory in a situation where nobody actually wins. I've stopped participating in these kinds of social media interactions a long time ago because, to be honest, it's exhausting. And they never actually change anything. It doesn't mean that you don't want to be a part of the solution when you stop cheering for road rage, for the very simple reason that the problem is not about us versus them. It's not about cars versus bicycles. The thing that we need to work on, first of all, is we need to chill, honestly. We need to take a step back, take a deep breath, and count to 50. Or maybe more. Yes, there really are bad drivers out there that terrorize the public. But there are also cyclists who just don't seem to get it. If we continue to approach the problem this way, things will never get better for anyone on the road. All of us who commute, drive, or walk on public roads and spaces are equal victims of bad infrastructure, for one. And bad policy could be another. But these are things that are generally out of our control. We can launch yet another petition or organize a crowd in the middle of the pandemic, but as one cycling advocate in Manila that was quoted in the New York Times article said, there's still widespread skepticism among local officials toward biking as a means of transport. We will need to continue the campaign to change mindsets. And that's probably a very accurate assessment of where we are right now. And speaking of changing mindsets, we need to understand that the change involves all of us. Change does have to take place in governance and policymaking, but it also has to take place in our personal lives. There are a ton of laws out there that has been around for decades, or longer, and yet none of them have been very effective in the absence of a cultural shift that makes the rules an essential part of daily behavior. Think of it this way. A pop singer who influences popular culture can make people wear weird pants and strange hairstyles. But an actual law that comes with legal consequences can't stop people from causing harm to animals. Or maybe a better example are the rules and penalties that can't even stop people from throwing candy wrapper on a sidewalk. In the Philippines, we have an expression, nakasanayan na yan kasi, which translates to, it's what we're used to doing. And there's probably no better proof than that statement that what we're trying to fix is a cultural problem. This is why no matter how insanely mad we can get when a motorcyclist uses a bicycle lane, or when a cyclist swerves onto a motor vehicle lane without signaling, we have to recognize that we are all equally fighting a force of habit that is almost genetically engineered into our behavior by way of culture. It's funny how culture is such a powerful thing that it can cause both good and bad things that influence human history, but a lot of us still discount its role in changing our habits on the road that most of us probably inherited from our parents. Maybe your dad used to honk at pedestrians. Maybe your mom hated motorists. It's like programming. Culture is code for human behavior, and to fix it, you have to rewrite some parts. I mean, you can't fix your computer by repainting the room where you work. You actually have to fix the problem. The thing that's worth talking about is that we don't have a culture of responsibility for others. Our behavior and our reaction is always driven by self-preservation and individual need. And I understand where that's coming from in an evolutionary way. But I think we've evolved enough to realize that selfishness never made anything genuinely better for anyone. Road safety is no different. It isn't about who's right or wrong. It's about whether we want to make things better or do we just want to keep on getting angry on the street and then ranting about it for a week on social media with a bunch of random people who, honestly, don't really care about you and are in it just for the rush of laying down profanities like a boss without any consequences. If you think about it, the lack of responsibility for our own actions is the very same reason why most of us get into road rage situations. The part that most of us will find awkward to jump into and participate in, but we have to, if we want to have less road rage and more respect on our public roads, is that we have to start being nicer to each other. If you see something bad happen, or if you find yourself in a situation that makes you angry, or makes you feel like you have to say something unkind, take a step back, breathe, and then ask yourself, do I want to be a part of an angry mob? Or do I want to be a problem solver? Now, if you say that you want to solve things, which you probably do if you're still listening, then congratulations, that makes two of us. All we have to do now is convince everybody else to do the right thing. Thank you for listening. I appreciate that you've taken the time to be here. This has been Spokes Nation, the Bike Scouts Community Podcast. If you found this topic interesting, please tune in every Wednesday on bikescouts.org or in Facebook groups. Just search for Bike Scouts Philippines. You can't miss it. Also, we'd be really happy if you can sign up for the Bike Scouts social platform for hope. Just go to bikescouts.org/beta. You'll be happy if you do. Until next time, ride safe and be well.